There's a couple of line items that are in their contract, dues and subscriptions, so we just put in whatever was in their contract. Also, the educational fees, $2,500, and this includes tuition, lodging, meals, and travel expenses. So each doctor, they negotiated per doctor. Any questions on that one or not?
And the rent building is for wherever they are?
Wherever that practice is.
Their actual office and patient rooms are.
Yeah.
Okay.
Of course, with the negative number here, in theory, all the places we saw where we were below budget and making money and increasing revenue in the first 20, four departments or whatever.
It was about 50, actually.
Is an offset from the negative number of Dr. Davis's practice, because his practice doesn't make money.
He feeds the hospital.
Yes, he makes money by having people in the hospital and having tests done and blah, blah.
Every provider feeds that hospital.
Right.
And you'll see some that are doing better than others, and that's just function of the practices, function, maybe how many patients they have in office.
But Dr. Davis's, in normal revenue, there's what, about $1,050,000?
Oh, I'm sorry, I switched tabs.
$1,060,000, and then you got your $500,000 down there below, so he actually did clear about $500,000 before his expenses.
Yes.
Okay.
It's kind of hard to do it when they're on separate pages, but.
Right.
This is Dr. Carpenter. So once again, his salary, you can see that between salary PTO per his contract. His was negotiated a little differently for whatever reason, I don't know, but it was for $5,000, which I just split between travel and educational fees. It doesn't have to be, I could have put just $5,000 in one, I guess. It doesn't really matter, but that's why it's broken out. And why this is more is that was negotiated in his contract.
Right.
I think part of that, just to clarify, is because of his medical directorship that he has out at the power plant requires him to have more CMEs, not to mention the fact that he puts in a lot of hours in the ER, which there's also requirements for the doctors to have additional education and training to work the ER as well.
He's got an MRO. I don't know if it's a certification or a certificate, but he's an MRO.
That's certification.
He's a medical review officer for the plant, so he's got to have the additional drug testing and have knowledge of all the street drugs and what people are on.
And you will notice at the bottom here, he does have other income from Luminant.
And that comes into us, yeah, that this is your regular, comes into us, yeah.
Okay, Dr. Hutch.
She is an intern, this generates, you know, I wouldn't say significant, but certainly generates more hospital revenue than your average kind of practitioner.
Mm-hmm. Your
well, I don't know. Dr. Burroughs does a lot more admissions than some.
That's why he said average.
She's not average. That was careful the way I said that. Yeah. I knew what I was saying, yeah. Good point.
DRG basis, she's probably taking care of sicker people if we're going to make more.
Well, yeah,
internists
treat more
disease. DRG level.
Mm-hmm. Of course, Dr. Hayes not here any longer, so we're moving on. Well, Dr. Peters. also is not here any longer.
This says Dr. Peters will be gone back, and this is the new
Khan.
Position.
There you go.
I'm sorry.
In theory, would take
his
place.
Dr. Yeah. Khan. Yeah.
We've adjusted the revenue up to
up here.
Reflect that.
Dr. Oak.
Has there been any bites on our search?
The other day,
yes.
we got a bite on a husband wife couple. So nothing. It's just a pretty good lead.
Mm-hmm. I got a nice email from the recruiter recruiting me for it.
There you go. All right.
we'll be glad to negotiate.
You know they're working.
Next is Dr. Patino.
Well, for some reason, I didn't realize he was part of the 501A.
He's a part-time 501A.
Yeah. Just in my mind, though, I thought he was doing something else.
And the salary reflects the part-time status.
Going down to the bottom here.
And see, you know, Doc, He's doing more work, and you see that that from an actual standpoint to a budget standpoint, we're budgeting a significant improvement in his practice.
Dr. Turk?
Yeah. We're going forward, Dr. Turk. We're going to start. Dr. Turk will be here through next September. So that's what we're reflecting in the budget.
Dr. Lawton's next.
Yeah, Dr. Lawton. I mean, I think it's one that we're going to have to really think hard about in terms of where we go with his practice and whether or not that's a practice that's going to grow or not. And you see the number kind of reflects that down at the bottom. We go down to the bottom number. There's a pretty significant loss. So I think that's.
But now comparing Dr. Patino is not fair at all. It would be more fair to compare him to.
Dr. Hutchison, that's correct.
And we don't want to do that either, so.
Well, there's, yeah.
Right.
Dr. Bosick is next.
Roughly, what's his patient volume at this point in his practice?
He is full. I mean, he is, we're not having any problems filling him up.
Right.
And he's gotten his credentialing and has started covering ER. And I know he was doing like three different shifts back to back.
Well, so, I think just his timing is coming, I think, with his involvement in the school and stuff. I think it's going nowhere but up.
I agree, and he's an easy sell to the community because he relates to this community, and they've embraced him. So right. And word of mouth has been great. We haven't had to invest an awful lot in advertising. You know, we've done things like get him out to the Citizen Center for public speaking, the same at Pecan, even though he doesn't work at Pecan. Mm-hmm. So we're getting a lot of revenue back for, you know, not much of an investment.
Mm-hmm. All right, folks, last tab.
Okay.
This is just our general department for the clinic.
And you will see there's meaningful use dollars down there in the line 23.
Oh, right.
Yeah, and the meaningful use for the 501A will continue through 2017.
Well, we're talking about that, there's a line item for, I don't know if it was in the ER budget or not, that when we can go back annually and bill the state of Texas for the intestine that we see in our ER. And so that was a pretty decent chunk of change that we were supposed to get from them last year.
Are you talking about trauma?
Trauma.
There's a trauma grant that we can, last year, I'm gonna say it was between 60 and 80,000.
That's what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a line item that we have in the budget for that?
That would have been under that general. I'm trying to think exactly what it's maybe grants under general.
Right.
It's a trauma grant, so that's probably where it would fall.
The only grant under general was that $6,600 one. No, this one
was a seven-figure number. It was, I think, the year before we'd only gotten $38,000 for it, and then we billed it differently or something. For whatever reason, out of all the junk I've had to sign up here, that one had to be notarized. Had to be witnessed, had to be, there was a lot of hoops to jump through for whatever that particular program was.
Yeah, it's a trauma grant. We get it every year. It fluctuates.
I noticed earlier when I looked at this again, I didn't have anything budgeted here for physician recruiting, so I guess probably need to plug something in there.
Yes, we do.
And I neglected to do that, sorry.
No, I neglected to give you the...
Yes, it was Susan's fault.
It's my fault.